Today on Beerus TV, it's the top 20 LG mistakes. There's 20 of them because there's a lot of mistakes out there.
There's four people out there, and one of these speaks to you. I definitely was one of these.
Yeah, so the first one is, you know what? You got this tank thing mastered. Never seen LG because you just beat it. You know all the ins and outs of everything.
Yeah, not me.
Second person, I'm just lucky. Third person, actually, LG just overrunning my tank, and I'm about to tap out. We solved that. and the third person, I'm seeing signs of it. And I'd like to catch it before it overruns a tank. You're probably one of those people raising your hand. Mm-hmm. All of you can benefit from today.
So really just choose your own adventure. Most of us are probably lumped into one of those four categories. And today you'll learn from our pitfalls, what we've learned over the years, so that you have an easier path than we did. And the first one starts with one of the most common mistakes is not cleaning your frags.
Yeah, so the frags come in and they have LG all over their base. It could be just like a light dusting of green algae. It could be bryopsis. Yeah. It could be bubble algae. It could be all kinds of things. Clean your frags.
Yeah, I just got a handful of Zoas today and it had algae all over it. And the first thing I did was, before I put it in my tank, scrub with a brush and a little hydrogen peroxide.
Hydrogen peroxide is my favorite tool. You can just go get it from the drugstore if you want. Hopefully there'll be a coral dip for it someday too. But hydrogen peroxide, you could paint it on with a paintbrush. You can just spray it on. A lot of corals are pretty tolerant of it. It will kill the algae, right?
And if you have some of those harder algaes that, or maybe even a coral that might have some, might have some algae on it, but you're not sure whether or not how it reacts to like hydrogen peroxide, the best is to, like you said, just applicate it on the brush and brush around it, or scrape off or manually remove as much as possible.
In fact, if you're interested in this, just go to YouTube and search for dipping my corals in hydrogen peroxide. You can see some really miraculous results.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, you can see like they dip it and then tomorrow, all of a sudden, all the things just super, super clean. In fact, if you want, also just cleaning the frags off and just scrubbing it is one thing. Really gotta like actually kill it because all the little microscopic bits will grow back. But you can actually break it off of the frag plug as well and just be free of it entirely.
Yeah, take the frag plug out of the equation. Algae's just not even there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I would absolutely consider hydrogen peroxide or any other tool, but clean the frags before they go in the tank so you don't get the algae that comes with them. All right, so number two here is?
This is lazy reefer syndrome and letting the algae become a plague and reaching catastrophic issues before actually doing something about it.
This is pretty common, that you see a little bit of algae in there, you don't do anything about it, and for some reason, like the alarm flags don't go up until the whole tank is just like waving in a sea of algae, right?
It's true.
Catch it way, way, way before that. So you will probably not know what to look for if this is your first rodeo.
Yeah, true.
But if you just start to see patches of it grow, do something about it then, instead of waiting for it to like get out of control, because it can take, if you let it go on forever, it'll take a long time to get it back out.
And that brings us to number three, and that is trying to take a sledgehammer to solve the problem and trying to cure algae in days, what it took you months to get to. So if you've reached those plague-like proportions, you've gotten to that point where algae's just everywhere, it probably took you some time. It's the stuff you didn't wake up and then algae was plagued in your tank. Or you didn't, maybe 2 weeks and you saw a little bit, but it wasn't plague-like. But then the mistake is going in there and attacking it and hoping that and trying to get it done in days because it took you months to get there.
Yeah, you're human. So we all like to see the magic cure
instant
come in.
Results.
Do magic dust. Algae's gone.
Yeah.
There are some tools for that. You'll talk about it a little bit today. But really, if it took you months to get in here, let it take months to get out. Just have some patience. And if you have that patience, first off, expectations are more likely to be met. And you won't be frustrated. Like, you just see incremental results. And in 4 months, this algae thing's no longer a problem.
Yeah.
Right? If you expect it to be solved in 4 days, you're probably going to be disappointed. So number four is turning your lights on day one, the moment that you filled it with water and dropped the rock in.
Well, I mean, the algae feeds not only on like our excess nitrates and phosphates, but even the initial cycle, ammonia and things like that too, it will feed on. And then most people probably aquascape with like a white, bone white dry rock, which is just, you're just kind of like building the perfect storm for algae to grow because you just cranked your lights on day one.
if you bought some super expensive live rock that like came out of the ocean and is filled with life, you may need to turn the lights on right away to keep some of that stuff alive.
Yeah, true.
If you're using dry rock and you turn the lights on most day one, yeah, you're probably going to grow some algae in many cases. So way better to just let the tank run with the lights either off or just barely on, and allow there to build like a biofilm and like a bacterial film on the surface of the rock that kind of prevents all the algae from taking hold. Meanwhile, in that first few months, just enjoy that you got a nice fish tank. Fill it up with fish, yeah, watch the fish, and enjoy this part of the progression of the tank. So it's not that you can't turn the lights on day one, but if you do and you run into algae, know why. All right, so this is super closely related to number five. What is it?
Hey, if I turn my lights on in the beginning and I don't have corals yet, I can just turn them off. So I've got fish in the tank, my hopefully utilitarian fish that are kind of eating away at the algae or helping keep it at bay. But if I just run into an algae problem and I don't have photosynthetic organisms that are in the tank that require the light, just shut the light off.
Yeah, so it's not a race. Enjoy your fish tank, enjoy the fish that are in there, add the corals after the light's been on for a little bit.
Yeah.
So let the lights be on for a month or so before you add any corals. And you can see if there's algae growth in your tank. And if there is, just turn the lights off, enjoy your fish tank, enjoy the fish in it, all the algae will go away because there's no light. And so you can just, again, allow that biofilm to build up and protect the tank from it. Meanwhile, like the algae will die, water changes and stuff will take the nutrients out. So don't be afraid to turn the lights off, especially if you haven't put any corals in. And in fact, maybe you don't want to add any corals in the beginning, just so you have that step available to you. Yeah. All right, so number six here is my own actual pet peeve because I see this done all the time.
I'm guilty.
What is it?
This is adding hundreds of snails and crabs as your cleanup crew. Like day one, I've made this mistake. I made this mistake in thinking, because you read all of these forums and years ago, forums was the only information we have. And everywhere I said it was like, add some hermits, add some red legs, blue legs, add some trocha snails, add the Mexican turbo snails. All of these cleanup crew is gonna help. Maybe a sea cucumber, maybe an urchin. Well, when I'm setting up my tank for the first time, there's nothing for these things to eat on. And so I thought I needed all of them. So I threw them all in there. I'm like, oh, look, I got live things in my tank. And then they turned into not live things.
Yeah, and when they die, they just add nutrients. And a little snail, it's a very meaty thing. So it's adding all that nitrogen and phosphorus from itself. And if it can't eat anything, it's actually consuming its own flesh, right?
Yeah.
And releasing those nutrients into the water. So essentially when you go in there and if you do it before you have any algae in the tank, you throw in 100 crabs and 100 snails, you're just putting little nutrient batteries into the tank and just overloading the tank with nutrients for no purpose. They're all gonna die. And on the second part of that, I already have algae problems. Sometimes I've seen people beat algae with an overwhelming amount of those things. But usually when the algae's gone.
Yeah, when their algae's gone, they go back to starving again and then
rinse, repeat.
Rinse, repeat.
Yeah, and so the right tool for the right job. And again, so if you thought 100 was gonna get me, solve this problem for me in a week, maybe 25 will solve it in the 2 months that I'm looking for.
Yeah.
Set the expectations for that. Don't just overwhelm it. And I'll say that this is, again, for me, I've seen the advice when people ask these types of questions out on the internet, but actually it's a lot also on the cleanup crew packages you see on the internet. There's like super
50,
duper packages, 60, 60 of these, 80 of those and whatever. And keep in mind, those people are trying to sell snails for a living, not actually necessarily solve your algae problem. So just keep that in mind and use the right tool for the right job. Pick the right amount. You don't want to overload the tank because you can actually have the opposite problem. All right, so that leads us into number seven, something a lot of people don't think of as a cleanup crew, but absolutely is.
Yeah, the cleanup crew of the utilitarian fish. So other than snails, other than crabs, when you see in the forums, or you see on the groups, cleanup crew, my mind automatically goes to crabs, snails, trochas, all these other things. But actually, it's the utilitarian fish, the fish with a purpose, that go attack the algae, and that's their primary diet. They can serve as an even better cleanup crew.
They can actually see the algae, seek it out, and eat it off. A snail just kind of has to stumble upon it, right? So I just haven't seen any instance where, I shouldn't say any instance, but many instances where utilitarian fish don't beat out snails and crabs. Mm. Now, they actually work better together, but I haven't seen people beat an existing algae problem with snails and crabs all that many times, but fish have seen it countless times.
You could
drop in a couple of the right fish, and boom, all the algae is just gone.
Rather than just, and not, not even even just solving an existing problem, solving a problem before it even starts. Mm-hmm. Like in the WWC BRS Hybrid series, when we have a whole episode just on utilitarian fish, and this is something that you can plan out before you even flip the lights on in your tank, and before you even come into an algae problem, is, you know, choose fish with a purpose, maybe a couple, you know, nice looking fish, but, you know, fish that actually have a job in the tank, so that when I kick my lights on, they're already trained to and attacking the algae before you even see it.
Yeah, you'll never even know there was an algae problem because they're handling it before there's just even hints of it, right? And so the other piece of this is, so what if I have a really small tank and I can't really get tangs in there? That isn't actually true. And so we did the 5-minute guide that had a 40 breeder and a E170, and we threw some tangs in there and got really small specimens. And the reality is those things can live in there for multiple years. And when they outgrow the tank, you can just swap them out with another one. I know you're pets, so you don't really want to swap out your pets. So the reality is if you make your first tank into the 2 or 3 year range, the chances of you upgrading that tank are super, super high. And you know, it's a perfect reason to. They, you know, your pets have kind of outgrown the space that you've given them, and so you go get more space. Or you want more pets, you know. Sometimes you change your yard if you got 2 or 3 dogs, right? And so the last piece of that really is that you can trade them out. And also, you know, if you want to, you can just trade them out and understand they are your pets, but you have other pets in the tank that are relying on you to keep the tank clean and sharp looking so that it stays up. All right, so number 8 is super closely related to this again. What is it?
Yeah, this is just replacing the cleanup crew when they die. I mean, let's face it. You come across the snail that's upside down, you come across a crab that's been picked on or got taken over by another crab. I mean, these things die, there's empty shells in the tank. So if you had a cleanup crew that isn't overabundance in the tank so that they actually have a constant food source and they're staying alive, well, when a few die back, put a couple more in.
Mm-hmm. This is a lesson that I learned in the very first, maybe the second year of reefing. Had my tank up, and all of a sudden we started bulk resupply. I had another job. I'm working from 6 a.m. until 9 p.m. every day, and the tank is getting neglected because my work day is full. Like, I don't got much time. Tank looks awesome though, right? Yeah. And then one day the yellow tank dies, right? Ooh. And I didn't connect it at first. But the tang dies, and then all of a sudden, algae out of everywhere, right? And then it just dawned on me that day, or like actually weeks later, is, wait a minute, that one fish, all he did all day was eat algae, right? And that's probably why I didn't have any algae. Mm. I dropped a new yellow tang in, and in a month, no more algae, right? So, you know, I don't want to treat the fish like they're replaceable, because that's not the case, but if you do happen to lose some of your cleanup crew and you're having a problem, you should replace them. You should identify why the fish died in the first place, but identify that and then go replace them so you can have a nice clean tank. All right, so mistake number 9
is not trying urchins. I mean, these are really cool critters. So pincushions, pencil urchins, you know, there's a wide variety of them. They look really awesome. Some of them carry your frags around the tank, which, you know, you can deal with, but a lot of them are really good lawnmowers for algae. I've seen them handle quite a bit of algae in a tank before.
It's been my experience that urchins are way better than crabs and snails. They do tend to carry stuff around and bulldoze stuff over, but some of the bigger snails do the same kind of thing.
That's true.
But if you got algae problems and you aren't solving it a different way, try a different tool and use the right tool again for the right job. Urchins are one. I know Chad actually breeds some urchins here, and he gave us little teeny baby ones for the ULM series. They grew huge because they were just mowing down algae all over the place. And I'd call that like actually a big component of a ULM is having that cleanup crew do all the work for you and eat all the algae so you don't have to like clean it up.
Yeah.
But absolutely try some urchins. All right, so the number 10 fail is actually not knowing what all of the options are. And there's one kind of unique one that I think people are like getting like more information on today than ever before, and it's?
Yeah, that's number 10 is not trying bacteria. So there are bacterial additives out there. You know, in most recent history here, it was trying Vibrant, and we do have a full Vibrant test that shows, I mean, this is bacteria that's designed to, or that, you know, does heterotrophic bacteria, so it eats some algae materials, and you can watch it in the tank. It actually works.
Okay, so I've never ever seen anybody like beat bubble algae with any product. Once in a while, I get lucky and someone eats it, but it's kind of like a perpetual thing.
Right.
I have seen now numerous cases where, in our own tanks, including this one right here, where Vibrant just wiped it out. It all just turns like silver, let's go, and like all of a sudden bubble algae's gone. Right? Mm. And it's that bacteria is actually going after it aggressively and consuming. It lives on surfaces. It cleans areas off that would have grown algae. In fact, a lot of people, we did it in the 5-minute guide tanks, dosed it right from the beginning, never had algae, even to start with.
No, and there was algae on the rock before we even put it in the tank, like visible algae, and that you would expect to like,
turn the lights on day one like we did.
And no issues.
Yeah, so consider like Vibrant as an option. There's also the Microbacter Clean from Brightwell and some other options out there for bacteria.
Yeah.
So consider bacteria as an option for fighting or even preventing any algae issue. Number 11 for me is very specific to one of the biggest pains in the butt algaes, which is bryopsis.
Yeah.
And like this is kind of the sledgehammer tool that almost always works. What is it?
Yeah, number 11 is not trying fluconazole. This is actually a really viable cure for or treatment for bryopsis. So we've done it multiple times in the BRS-160. We've seen it done around the office and dose it, bryopsis gone.
So I've seen people try to solve this like with, you know, raising the magnesium up to like 2,500 or some crazy number. I've seen like all kinds of solutions to this that like have various degrees of results and probably stress the hell out of the tank. And outside of all that stuff, I gotta tell you, I think that the fluconazole actually is the easiest solution. I won't say that it has like zero effect on the tank. I've never seen any tank like get wiped out by it or anything. I've seen some corals look like they're a little bit stressed by it, but they definitely are getting stressed by overwhelming the tank in bryopsis, which is like a fern type algae if you look really close at it, and not something anybody wants to run into. So if you're running that, like this is one of the best options out there.
Yeah, this was in the 160 when we ran into this. It was, there was tissue loss at some of the bases of the corals, and when you get those tissue loss, especially in those acropora corals, of course, but when you get that tissue loss, it gives a place for algae to take hold and then just irritates the coral even further. So deep within the insides of some of these acropora colonies, we're getting a bryopsis in there and nothing is growing. It can't grow over the top of algae, and it's something that the utilitarian fish, most of the time, I've never seen a utilitarian fish go after bryopsis, but 2-week cure or 2-week treatment of this and we were back to good, and now we're actually growing back over the dead skeleton.
Yeah, so sometimes a double treatment, 2 weeks, get rid of it, another treatment to like just knock it out for sure, right? So I'd probably do that at later stages, but the one treat, I would absolutely consider this as an option. And again, like if you're losing corals and stuff, you can just stop that in its tracks all the way. So definitely consider fluconazole specifically for bryopsis. All right, so number 12, again, is one of my pet peeves here. So which is it?
Yeah, this is assuming that dirty water is good. Dirty probably to some people means different things. When I think about it, dirty water to me means like, I picture a softy tank or an LPS tank, and I picture like high nitrates, high phosphates, something I'm not really taking too concerned with of removing. And for a lot of people, they think that that's okay.
Yeah, so for me, dirty water is synonymous with uncared for. End of story. So it doesn't mean you can't maintain like reasonable levels of nitrate and phosphate, but do it intelligently. Because if you just let them rise and you're like, well, everything looks fine. Yeah, just wait, man. One day, all of a sudden, it will be a tipping point, and it happens fast because there's so much nutrient in the water for it to explode. So usually it happens when some other thing stresses out the tank, stresses out the corals, and all of a sudden, like, it just gives way to this thing to explode. So if you think that nitrate and phosphate in your tank having super high levels in there is super good for the tank, I won't argue about whether it's good or not for the corals, but it is absolutely good for algae and growing that. So, you know, consider whether or not you want to maintain those levels intelligently, but I certainly wouldn't think that dirty water is good for the tank. So number 13 is again related to nutrients.
This is feeding your fish too much. You walk up to the tank and you get the reaction from the fish because they know usually there's food coming, so they follow you. They look hungry, a lot of people say, and sometimes they'll accept food too. But do they necessarily need the food is the question.
Yeah, so here's the story. Are you feeding too much? There's one way you'll know, is nitrate and phosphate levels just continually rise. So if their nitrate phosphate levels just continually rise in your tank, one of two problems is happening. A, you're just feeding too damn much, or your filtration just isn't good enough for the amount that you want to feed. You can fix either one of those things, but like I would absolutely, you know, at least track one of those things. With phosphates, probably the easiest one to track because a little checker is so easy to do. But track one of them and understand that, like, if all those things are rising, the nutrients in my tank are rising, it's because I'm putting too much food into the tank. It's not too many fish, it's too much nutrient going into the tank to feed the fish. So fix your filtration or stop feeding so much. So number 14 is super common as well, and it's not understanding like, well, I don't have a nutrient problem. I have zero nitrate and zero phosphate, but I got tons of algae. What's the problem?
This is not recognizing that the nutrients are actually bound into the algae because it's uptaking it. So there's really nothing left in the water column when you're testing for phosphates and nitrates because the algae has a hold of all of it and it's continually sucking it up as more is added to the tank.
Essentially, you have an in-tank refugium, right? All of the hair algae and stuff is sucking up all of the nutrients out of your tank. Yep. So it looks like you have zero, but you actually are adding all of that nutrient every day. It's just getting sucked up by the algae so fast you can't test for it. So number 15 here is a mistake that I've actually made in the past, and it is?
Yeah, this is not removing the algae manually. So if I have an overgrowth or if I have anything that I can really just grab with a pair of tweezers or grab with my thumb and forefingers and just kind of rip out manually. Better yet, if I'm manually removing it, so I'm in this cleanup mode, I'm in, like, doing my weekly maintenance, scrubbing off the rocks, I'm just blowing off algae off of the rocks and it's floating all over the tank, it's a mistake to not get that out of there because as we just talked about in 14, all of the nutrients that are bound up in that algae, if we just let it go, we're just starting the cycle over again.
You know, I've done that actually. And so, like, I've scrubbed off all of the bryopsis or whatever and scrubbed off every surface. And really, that just tends to spread it, by the way.
Yeah.
But, like, it all just went in the tank. I didn't remove it. It's just going to die. And it's just going to add more nitrate and phosphate to the tank, you know, like feeding the new problem. I didn't actually remove it. So one of the things I would suggest is not scrubbing it off in a manner where it just spreads all over the place. But if you can get like a siphon and grab it with your thumb over the siphon, pull it off, let your thumb go, and then it just sucks right up into the siphon, right? Eliminating from the tank. So you're not just taking the organism, the pest organism out of the tank, you're also taking the nutrients that it used to feed on out of the tank with it so it doesn't feed the next problem. So this is a really, really big one. Manual removal. Don't expect the magic cure here. Or like, if I was going to use fluconazole, the first thing I would do is manually remove as much of it as I humanly possibly could, and then solve the problem with some of the other tools. Don't just like expect the tool's going to solve all the work for you. Do the manual removal first and keep up with it.
Yeah.
Again, we talk about like, you know, you got 3 months in to cause this problem. It might take 3 months to get it out. So once a week, pull all this stuff out manually. So number 16, we actually kind of already touched on it, but there's some different ways you can use this tool as well, and it is?
The mistake here is missing the usefulness of hydrogen peroxide. A couple ways that I've seen it done around here is, like we talked about right off the bat, scrubbing some, spraying some, dipping in hydrogen peroxide, your coral frag plugs, and that way you just kind of see the algae turn white and then eventually just dissolve away.
Mm-hmm.
I've also seen it in the clown harem tank with Chad, where Chad would drain the tank super low as it was doing a water change, and while the tank or while the algae was exposed on the rock surfaces, take a bottle with a spray top and just spray hydrogen peroxide directly onto the algae. He lets it sit for a little while, fills the tank back up, and over the course of doing that for a few weeks, all of those algae tufts start to turn white, dissipate, and disappear.
So this was pre-fluconazole days, but like we had bryopsis super bad in that tank because there's so much food going in to feed the 30 clownfish in there. But the solution that we came up with was drain the tank like within an inch of the bottom of the water, spray the actual spots with the hydrogen peroxide. It would kill it, you know. And then we would add some urchins to the bottom inch where there's still the algae in there. Manual removal as much as you can.
Yep.
And between those three things, the urchins would actually eat it all off, and we just killed it with this thing. So think about hydrogen peroxide as a tool and how you could use it to your specific need. All right, so number 17, we're getting deep in the catalog here. What is it?
Yeah, this is failing to keep up with your maintenance and failing to actually do your maintenance. We're talking water changes specifically. I mean, I can blow off the rocks and do my water changes. But, you know, we all get a little lackadaisical, especially, you know, come summertime and I want to be outside. Or, you know, my tank just looks good and I don't have to do water. I feel like I don't have to do water changes. Combination of that piling up on each other is leading to the inevitable, you know, algae outbreak.
So here's the thing. There's a lot of people out there that say, I never do my water changes. I don't do them all summer long and my tank's just fine. Yeah, there's tons of those people that are willing to go out there and say that. And a lot of the people that won't say that, you won't hear from because they just don't exist.
Yeah.
Right?
Like
that went well
anymore.
For a long time, and then somewhere in the next 2 years, it totally went south for them, overrun with algae, and they just quit the hobby.
Yeah.
So you don't actually hear from those people because they're gone. Right?
Yeah.
So yeah, keep up with your water changes. There's one thing I've learned that it's absolutely, if you do them, you're in a way higher percentage pool than if you don't. And I think even the people that don't do water changes will agree that that's probably the case. Auto water changes being
key.
My like hybrid of all
this. Oh yeah, for sure. I do not want to lug a bucket of water anymore. I don't want to carry the bucket over the top of the tank. I don't want to run pumps. It's just an amount of time that now that I know that auto water changes exist and I can do this just constantly throughout the day and all I have to do is mix up a vat of salt water and I'm good to go, maybe change that every once a month or so. Then water changes are easy for me to do and I'm more apt to do them if something else is doing it for me.
There's a few options, like you can do a do-it-yourself auto water change. The Neptune Dose is a good one that we use here.
The Versa pumps
now from Ecotec. And then Thomas Burton did one on the auto wet change from Auto Aqua.
Yeah, Auto Aqua AWC, which is an ATO built in too. Really good for small tanks too.
Okay, so you can go check out his spotlight on that one. But yeah, there's a lot of options for auto water changes, kind of hybrid if you like don't really want to do them, but you know the benefits of doing it. All right, so number 18, this one's been kind of evolutionary over the last 4 or 5 years and just our understanding of it. What is it?
This is not considering a refugium, algae scrubber, or even an algae reactor. Yes, I want to grow algae. I just don't want to grow it in the front and where my tank is. I want to grow it down in my sump or targeted somewhere in my system, not in the display, in which case the refugium, the algae scrubber, absolutely the tools that can do that.
Yeah, so algae's not my friend.
Yeah.
Right? I want to grow algae to prevent it from going in the display, suck up all those nutrients. So like algae scrubber is essentially growing hair algae in a little box. You scrape it off, throw it in the trash. Refugiums typically like a Catomorpha, and you can grow it you know, and in a lot of different areas of your sump. And then if you want like a really compact version, like I don't have area for a big old refugium, now they sell the algae reactors, and you know they're a tube with a light on it. Tunes has got one, Skim's got one. There's a variety of them out there. So any one of those options, like consider, actually I want to grow algae now, I just want to grow it in a controlled manner where I can harvest it instead of growing it in the tank. Okay, so number 19 is actually kind of funny, and what is it?
Hey, if your skimmer sucks, get a better one. We're talking about skimmers that are either underpowered or underrated, or maybe even don't have, you know, the controls that you want to, you know, match the nutrient input and the export. So you have that air-water mixture inside, and this is a tool that I can dial in as my tank changes or as my need changes.
Yeah. So whatever skimmer you're using, if it isn't doing what you want it to do, you know, whatever brand it is, doesn't matter. If it's not performing the way you want, you know, you can suck out a lot of that fish poo and rotten food and everything and all the nutrients related to it using the filter as it's intended. So, you know, there's a lot of different, we did a whole bunch of skimmer videos out there, so we won't talk about it all today. You can go watch those. You can also watch the best of the year and all those different things. But, you know, get the right tool for the right job, and if you're not happy with your skimmer performance, you don't have to live in that world. And there's more information than ever out there on how to get the right tool for the right job. All right, so number 20 here is actually my personal favorite. You should absolutely do this, and it's a fail if you don't. If you're running into algae problems, you don't do this. Big, big fail.
Yeah, we made a 5-minute guide for algae control and a bunch of other things too, but algae specific. And we've used the steps in there to defeat some algae problems around the office here. So it is a mistake that if you're in algae and you're running into algae problems, for you to not take 5 minutes and go watch this video.
Yeah, so what we did in this video is take the least aggressive approaches and then put them in series so you can know really distinct guidance on how to beat something and, you know, in series to the more aggressive approaches at the end. But like, instead of seeing a sea of go do all of these things, no, do this one, then this one, then this one, and stop when you beat the algae in your tank, right? But real distinct advice, you're gonna probably, if you got an algae in your system or you just like to prevent it, you're probably gonna spend hours and hours and hours of research and hours and hours and hours of effort. Spend the 5 minutes to get like something really distinct, a real path that works in vast, vast majority of cases. Okay, so if you only heard one thing today, let it be this. A dirty tank is synonymous with an uncared for tank and not a good path for your reef tank.
Even better than that, the utilitarian fish should be considered some of the best cleanup crew out there. And if you want to see that BRS-WWC hybrid episode that we talk about how to choose utilitarian fish and what they can do for you, potentially solving all your algae problems for good, check that video out right here.